to stand up and tell us that our enemies are not really our enemies. That is a factor that is missing, and not letting everybody unite behind armed forces for the struggle that they're doing. As many people come and say on the media, we are fighting a war for the country, and it's trying to save not only its geographic boundaries, but its ideological boundaries. And that's something in which I think we need to stand up wherever we are and show our resolve and resilience and support towards the armed forces.
Okay.
Two, three thoughts I leave with you on this. I'm a student of strategy, and therefore, if you look at the entire picture from that perspective, this will become a bit clearer to you. Number one, in this kind of war, it is not armed forces versus armed forces. It is actually armed forces and the terrorists fighting each other, and the medium is the society as a whole. And success or failure lies more in the psychological domain rather than in the physical domain. You lose or win psychologically in your minds. And as they say, if you look at such like wars, you should look at the people in three groups. There is a small group on one side, which is pro-government, or trying to save the system which is there. And there is a small group which is trying to destabilize and trying to replace that system by something else that they want, and for which they're convinced as per their ideology. And there is a huge block of neutral population in the middle, which is the victim of the fighting of the two. And it is the success within that huge block which will give victory to either side. Now, this example of Sawat is, I think, very good for all of us. There was a time when Army did an operation back in 2007, and the people of Sawat were at that time supporting the terrorists, and therefore the success was not as much as you see today. But what has happened now is that the people have, that huge block has turned against these terrorists, and they are with the armed forces, and therefore you have succeeded there. So, as they say, gorilla is like a fish, and society is like water. Deprive them of the environment in which they can survive, and they will die. Yes. The nation has to, as a whole, unite and kill these elements who are within us. They have supporters, they have people who handle them, there are people who assist them, there are people who go and launch them, actually. Mm-hmm. Now, if that system is not there, they won't be able to do anything to you.
Okay, I would like to add on that, sir, Kamal Shah has to leave in another 10 or 15 minutes or so. So therefore, any questions directed can be asked, and then we can further continue.
I have a question for Kamal Shah, actually.
Okay, sir.
Sir, you already talked about that there's a strategy in place to fight extremism. I have just a point to make and need your comment on that. What do you think that, as it is said, that an idle mind is a devil's workshop? So these people who are in the tribal areas, let's say, involving the government policies into it and making and giving might be politicizing the discussion. But don't you think that when the displaced people, they're given a token money, let's say about 3,000 rupees a month, 5,000 rupees a month, and not imparting a particular skill set in them. So you think that this should be included in developing a strategy, or is one of the major fundamentals in evolving a strategy to fight extremism? Because when we impart a particular skill set, let's say all those who are wandering into the mountains of tribal areas, so at least they'll be busy in some particular thing. Their healthy activity and a healthy mind will generate something good for Pakistan as well. And this is a step we are taking under the complete paraphernalia of cultivating hope might be. Because I'm not sure that whether we are also thinking on these lines, or the government is imparting, or in near future they are planning that they'll create skilled labor, or they'll create certain skill sets there. So please, sir, if you...
Well, Tipu, it's a very good question, and what you say is absolutely right. I share your view. Paying token money is not the solution. Because if you pay him, say, 5,000, 10,000, 20,000, 100,000, 500,000, he's going to spend them one day, and then again would start looking around for something. So it has to be a package. I fully agree with you. And the package has to be that those who are not educated, those who are not illiterate, they need to be imparted skillful training. They need to be imparted training of various kinds where they could be gainfully employed, where they could earn their livelihood. I mean, we could also export our people when, if they are skilled, if they acquire skills. So, and skills, of course, different levels, different types, and different kinds. So, as far as FATA is concerned, since you referred to FATA, I made a reference to the to the remedial measures. So it's not only paying cash to someone and then feeling satisfied that it will all be okay. Certainly not. We need to open up FATA as far as education is concerned. We need to expand education. We need to provide them all other facilities. Imagine a person traveling from South Waziristan. General Asghar, Brigadier Rana, and perhaps most of you would bear me out that it's not the other facilities other than education, communication, roads, health facilities, and all those facilities are non-existent. So we need to really development, and the policy which was which has been announced by the present government, by the Prime Minister, on the floor of the House is 3 Ds. It's dialogue, interacting with people, development. And development encompasses all these things which you are referring to. And deterrence only as a last resort, and deterrence would mean use of force. So I entirely agree with you, and there should be no two opinions about it, that we need to focus on all these aspects.
Okay. We have room for one or two more questions. Okay. All right, introduce yourself, please.
Assalamu alaikum. I'm Maryam Qureshi, student of PBA. I've talked from my own personal experience. In about January this year, the police came to our house and said that 2 suicide bombers have been dispatched from my father, and we were asked to shift immediately. Now, my question is, it's December now, and mashallah, alhamdulillah, we're all perfectly fine. Okay. Are we actually supposed to believe these threats? Because my father is completely chilled. He does not believe anything. Even if he does, at least he doesn't show that to us. So that's my only question. And from where do you actually get this information?
Intelligence.
Right, Madam Maryam Qureshi, you, I don't know which level people came to your house, whether they were junior officers or senior officers, but in all such cases, it should be a very senior level, at least of the superintendent level, superintendent of police or senior superintendent of police, who should be interacting with families like you. And well, shifting you from your house to some other place is not the solution. So I presume, without asking you, that the level was certainly must have been extremely low, because yet now, as far as information is concerned, your question that where does it come from, where does this information emanate from? Well, these are different sources. Through intelligence agencies, we have this federal intelligence agencies, the civil intelligence agencies, the army intelligence agencies. We have the provincial, we call them special branches. They are the intelligence agencies. Then there are other intelligence agencies which are called CIDs, criminal investigation departments. So I really won't know which source this particular information came from, but whenever such information is received, I'm glad and I'm very happy that nothing untoward has happened to your family, and we pray that your father lives a very long and happy and healthy life. But such information is not to be viewed lightly.